Okay, good morning, and welcome to the session, Deterrence in Cyberspace. The session is a panel, so let me introduce you to the moderator, Deborah Feyerick, independent journalist at CNN, national correspondent. Please, the stage is yours. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I want to introduce our distinguished guests here today. First of all, we've got Thomas Wingfield, who is with the Department of Defense, Liesyl Franz, who's with the State Department, Adam Hickey with the National Security Division of the Department of Justice, and Steve Kelly, who is with the FBI. All of them are experts in cyber. Their titles are up there, and this should be a very dynamic conversation. The first thing I'd like to do is I'd like to open up by asking you for 5 words on what you see as the greatest challenge right now to deterring attacks in cyberspace. Tom.
Deterring malefactors and supporting friends.
Okay. Liesyl.
There is strength in numbers.
Adam.
It's easy to be a punk, but punks don't deter.
Right. Steve.
Without attribution, there isn't deterrence.
Very good. So I want to set the stage. I know this is a very sophisticated audience, but I do want to set the stage a little bit because for the last several years, the attacks against the United States have really been relentless. They've gone after U.S. critical infrastructure. They've gone after companies that are a critical part of the supply chain. You look at NotPetya, Russia, it attacked shipping, it attacked pharmaceuticals, it attacked FedEx, a subsidiary of FedEx. There was WannaCry, North Korea. China has gone after all the personal information that we possibly own from the OPM breach when 21 million people were hacked to the Equifax breach where now 145 million people's personal data was stolen. Iran, of course, the same. They're data mining and attacking dams and critical infrastructure. So yesterday on one panel, the Director of Defense Policy for NATO basically said the two most important reasons that these countries are doing this is one, because it's a way for them to assert themselves, and two, because they can probably get away with it. So why wouldn't they do it? So the first question is America striking back as a form of deterrence? Tom.
America's taking on these threats through working with our interagency partners. In DoD, we are outward focused, and we are, you're gonna hear the phrase a lot, defending forward. That's our strategic approach, where we are trying to get to the threats as close to the source as possible and operationally persistently engage. So we are always out there, always aware, and always ready to deal with threats as they emerge. So from the DoD perspective, the answer is definite yes, but that is only one small slice of the overall problem.
Is there, in terms of deterrence, is there some sort of level where something would have to happen where the response would be sort of almost the nuclear option, as we used to call it, right? There's everything leading up to that, and then there's something that just is so unacceptable.
Well, just looking at it, you can think of deterrence with a capital D, which is nuclear deterrence or strategic deterrence, a nation state threatening catastrophic damage in response to catastrophic damage. That has worked well for the last 60 or 70 years. We have not seen that. However, that doesn't work well either with non-state actors or below the threshold of catastrophic damage. As a matter of fact, you might say it hydraulically increases the likelihood of non-catastrophic activities. If you mean deterrence with a lowercase d, then channeling General Nakasone here, commander of US Cybercom, he says deterrence comes from day in, day out, being out there and dealing with threats on a consistent basis. And that's that kind of lowercase d deterrence is one of the centerpieces of what the DoD is doing.
Adam, let me jump to you. The National Security Division is responsible for countering nation-state threats. So what is being done today that was not being done even 5 years ago?
Sure. I think you have to go back a little bit beyond 5 years, but it's relatively recent that we treated state-sponsored computer intrusion set attacks as something more than an intelligence problem. In other words, the framework used to be, well, you don't want to do anything visible or noisy, because if you do that, the actors are going to change what they're doing, they're going to change their infrastructure, and we're going to lose what we know about them. So be very quiet. And the problem with that approach is that it's not how we treat any other national security threat. It's not how we respond to espionage. It's not how we respond to terrorism. What we typically say is law enforcement's one of the tools of the government. It's one tool of federal power, and we should deploy it intelligently to affect the actor. And so two shifts we made. One, we are collecting information with an eye towards bringing to bear individual consequences under law, and that typically means prosecutions, right? So we are bringing cases that we never used to charge 10 years ago. Second, we're aware of the fact that in many of those cases, we may not have the opportunity to arrest the individual. We bring the case based on the same standards and the same protocols, but we, you know, charging a case is reactive. It's good to hold individual actors accountable, but that alone is not sufficient. So we're looking for ways to take what we learn and disrupt their activities by getting court orders or the like that allow us to seize infrastructure, or building a record that enables other agencies like state and DOD, for example, to take action or to bring what we've investigated to the international community and say, collectively, we ought to take action. So I think that's one of the more impactful things we've been able to do in the last, say, 7 to 8 years.
And so, for example, the most recent case against Equifax, you read the indictment there, it goes into great detail about how they did it, how they were doing it, what they were after. So, Liesyl, from a State Department perspective, how does that help you? And is there any policy that's really in place that says, you know, we need to go after these people?
Well, I guess I would start with, it's no surprise that at the State Department, we might think of diplomacy with a capital D, and utilizing the tools that have long served foreign policy, you know, long before cyber came into the picture. But because it has, how do we use those traditional tools and try to affect the decision-making calculus of leaders in other countries? So all of the information and all of the tools that the other agencies bring to bear provide a great amount of foundational input into what we might do on a diplomatic effort. And we've started that many years ago, sort of as the beginning of, you know, the types of attacks that we saw and knew that there would need to be some kind of addressing what states might do in that context. And so many years ago, started a process in the UN to sort of set a framework for what was responsible state behavior. And that framework has led us to, those deliberations led us to a framework that, you know, sort of sets the stage for what is acceptable state behavior. International law applies to cyberspace, so we don't need a new treaty to deal with this. It's not the Wild Wild West in that case. We have established a set of what we call norms, voluntary non-binding norms of responsible state behavior in peacetime, which goes to the threshold question that Tom, you mentioned. And then maybe a more practical piece is how nations can be in dialogue with each other and share information, what we call confidence building measures, applying those to cyberspace as well. What are the points of contact? What is your national approach? What's your national doctrine? What are the kinds of things that you, the institutions that you have to deal with these issues? And those are all aimed at reducing conflict and reducing the chance of escalation. So now what we do, if you have this framework, and all the members of the United Nations have agreed to be guided by this, by these principles, and if somebody, if a state takes action that's contrary to that, what do you do? So how do you deter in that context? And when I said strength in numbers, what I meant was we're going to work with other countries so that we're not acting alone. So that's the partnership aspect, I think, that Tommy talked about as well.
So with respect to when you talk about states acting responsibly and what is responsible behavior, you can look at cyber as asymmetric warfare. Nation states will see that as really their policy on cyber, right? They want to make sure that they're relevant. They want to make sure that they've got a voice in the world. Russia's economy is number 13, and they're attacking the country that has the number one economy, right? So they're using this as a policy to make inroads, to get what they want, to gain an advantage over what they see as their adversaries. So what is that responsible behavior? Because it doesn't seem like Russia's abiding by it, or China, or Iran, or North Korea, for that matter. So how would you just define responsible behavior? And anyone can jump in on that, but Liesyl.
Well, maybe I'll just start with the norms piece, which is in the group of governmental experts that came up with this set of norms. There are some key ones. One is that CERTs, or Computer Security Incident Response Team, should be used for good and not for malicious behavior. That a state should not undertake activity that attacks the critical infrastructure of another state. If you are, if a state comes to you with a request for assistance or a question about the cyber, then you respond. These kinds of things are what we collectively in this group have put forward as a framework that establishes what is responsible. Now, in what we've seen, I think you could argue that some states have decided not to adhere to those, and I can't speak to their reasons, all of their reasons. I think any number of folks here at the conference have had different characterizations about what those might be, but along the lines of what you outlined, Deborah, what we have heard, you know, Russia holds itself out as a responsible actor. So if that's the case, then we need to call them out, and we've done so.
So building on what Adam said, putting together these very intricate, complicated sort of indictments so that everyone knows specifically what it is they're doing. Not a secret, right? No way to deny it, it's based on evidence. From the perspective of the FBI, are you able to have a relationship with people in what we would call our countries that are not friendly, and get the kind of help from law enforcement that you need, or are there workarounds? What is the biggest challenge gathering all that evidence to help Adam put together his case so that Liesyl can go and make policy? And so,
yeah, that's a great question. I mean, the ultimate the challenge simplified is that most of the actors that are affecting the U.S. are not in the U.S. using attack infrastructure that's all over the world, including in third countries, and affecting entities that are here domestically. And it crosses these geopolitical lines and these agency mission lines, and it creates complexity in gathering information and evidence. So it is quite challenging to be able to solve the case. You heard my five words earlier, highlighting the importance of attribution in creating deterrence and achieving deterrence. Some people kind of scoff at the idea that we're going to be successful in deterring these types of activities because they're happening all the time. So clearly we didn't deter the last one. But I think that the idea that we've been working on with State Department and like-minded partners is that we need to be better and faster at identifying who did it and being in a better position to impose consequences more rapidly, so that we can begin to achieve that. So this is much different than the nuclear context, where this stuff is happening all the time, and some of the activity just falls within the pure criminal realm. And of course, the rubric is the law that we're trying to enforce and deter people from violating is the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, which is our hacking statutes. Most countries have something similar. But then when you kind of get beyond that into some of these state activities, then we are looking at how does this comport with what we can expect in international behavior, and for instance, probably the most popular with me of the group of governmental experts norms is the not using an intelligence service to steal intellectual property and trade secrets for commercial gain of the domestic industry. So that's one that is really important to us, and you've seen Justice Department cases around that.
Adam.
Yeah, just one point to add. I mean, it probably doesn't surprise you that a nation is not going to cooperate with a request for records about what its own employees are doing, right? We wouldn't send Russia or China an AMLAT request and say, please give us the toll records for this presumably state actor. That would really undermine our credibility, actually, I think. But the lack of cooperation extends beyond that to actors that are acting only for their own enrichment or profit. And I think we shouldn't lose, when we talk about norms and state behavior, we're not just talking about how states should regulate the conduct of their intelligence officers and military and proxies. We are also talking about whether states just believe in the rule of law generally, and whether they make distinctions about whether to cooperate based on what is the law, and do I have an obligation in good faith to share evidence of this ransomware attack or business email compromise? Or do I decide whether to cooperate based on whether it's my national or not, or whether I get something from it? That second category of decision-making calculus, which is very much not the US's, is a problem for us, right? You have nations that are saying, whether I help you or not depends on whether I get something out of it. And for most of the post-World War II order, law enforcement has relied on cooperation from nations because we all are better off if we're cooperating to identify criminals are. And so that's a norm I want to emphasize too.
Okay, Steve?
So just a little bit of a redirect. So to kind of finish up answering the question you originally posed, it takes a lot of cooperation from a lot of different stakeholders to be able to prove the set of facts that gets us from a crime here to the actors that are behind it. It requires a lot of assistance and work with the victims. And so to the extent that there are organizations that are victimized and they're not reporting those to law enforcement, we can't even begin. So it requires a lot of cooperation with victims. It requires a lot of cooperation with other stakeholders that within the IT ecosystem. And then foreign partners, there's lots of examples of where our cases involve cooperation from 10 or 15 different countries, a number of private sector entities, and of course the victims. So it's quite remarkable what we can achieve when we're focused on trying to solve the issue. I think the recent cases where we're able to tie a computer intrusion and a theft of information to actual individuals to be able to put their names and pictures on a wanted poster is remarkable. 15 years ago, it would have been, who could have predicted? And now this is becoming a routine. So I think nations and the individuals that are working on their behalf can no longer assume that they can operate with anonymity. We have the ability to pierce that.
So when we talk about attributing and acting quickly, how does that factor into decisions made at the Pentagon?
When it comes to attribution, obviously there's a technical component, and that is finding out who did it. And sometimes that's very quick and easy, and sometimes that takes a little bit longer. But then there are a couple other components. One component is what is the intelligence gain loss of revealing that we know who did it? Maybe the country will be better off if we just follow those activities and don't go down one road or another where we make that public. Another component that we would have to look at with attribution is working with not just in the interagency, but with partners and in international partners. Because Liesyl's talking about having an international stance for the rule of law, it's very important that when we do that, we do it as coherently as we possibly can, so it just doesn't seem of a game of all against all.
So it's interesting. So from a civilian perspective, right, I look at the ability to, who reveals what they know. And it's not always coming quickly from the government. It's coming more often from the private sector, right? But as sort of a regular person, I think, wow, but NSA and Cyber Command, they know so much. And we don't know what they know, but should we maybe know what they know? Because maybe that would give people greater peace of mind, for example. So how does that factor in? And how does that sort of influence, I guess, how the behaviors of the United States and what they're doing, if not to not only to deter, but also to disrupt?
Well, obviously, it's very difficult to explain that we know this, this, and this, when that would kind of blow the whole thing of what we do know and how we're going to try to end it or learn how to end something worse in the future. But I think the best example is looking in the rearview mirror. There have been some marvelous attributions and some great work in the interagency and with international partners. And you can think of a few countries that have suffered intrusions, and we've been part of that attribution. And if we continue doing that, I think that's it's not a zero-sum game. We're able to keep most of the forward-looking secrecy that we have to keep the country safe. We keep that preserved, but looking back, without going into the exact details of how and who, we can see, wow, this criminal group was uncovered, or wow, this group working with an adversary government was shown to be doing what it's doing. So I think putting those, optimizing in those two directions are what we should be working toward.
Liesyl, do you sometimes sit at the table and are frustrated with some of the countries that you're dealing with and what you're asking for, the kind of policies you're trying to make? What is the sort of pushback that you might be getting about what you would like to see happen, not just for the cybersecurity of the United States, but globally, and what some countries are saying, well, we just can't do that? What are the sticking points, the pushback?
Well, I think that, I'm not going to say we're never frustrated across a diplomatic table, but I will say that the conversations that we have had that laid the foundation, like I said, these discussions about responsible state behavior and coming to that took a long time, but now gives a foundation for countries to be able to sit down and have a common conversation. A conversation with, okay, this is what we've set out as the framework. What do we do? What are the words we use? How do we work together? What is the most effective way to either go public about an attribution, like what we recently did with Russia's attack on Georgia? And we worked with a great number of countries and were able to agree on a way to make this attribution and that countries could make statements of their own that would either directly attribute, as we did, or do supporting statements condemning the behavior, which is also a very supportive action. So with us, it was 20 countries, then plus the high representative of the European Union made a statement on behalf of the EU and member states. So that's what I meant by strength in numbers. So the conversations we have, they're not frustrating. It's been incredibly affirming, actually, that we can now have those kinds of conversations that show that coordinated and supportive diplomatic and public statements. What we also need to do is build that. It's not frustrating, but it's a goal and objective to build that tent of countries that we can have those same kinds of conversations with, and have them make the decision as well to support such attributions, condemn such malicious behavior, so that we make the tent even bigger.
So Adam, it's the National Security Division's responsibility to protect critical infrastructure and the private sector. The private sector is responsible for a lot of the critical infrastructure when we look at the banks and utilities and other companies. Are you finding that the information that you're getting from the private sector is substantial enough to really form cases that give you better insight into what's happening, not just in those that are self-reporting, but also in those that might be victims but are not coming forward?
So I think we've benefited a lot in the last few years in a shift of culture. I think to some extent the scarlet letter that used to attach if you suffered a data breach has been mitigated somewhat because of an understanding publicly that the internet is an inherently porous and vulnerable architecture, so a determined adversary with enough time and resources is probably going to get in. So whether there was a breach or not, that binary question is not enough if you want to evaluate. Answering that is not enough to evaluate whether a company behaved responsibly. Instead, you want to understand how quick were they to identify it? Did they build an architecture, a security architecture that allowed them to mitigate the consequences quickly before it was detected? And did they do the responsible thing and contact law enforcement? And so that shift in culture has led more companies to contact us. And that is critical to the attribution question a lot of the times, because we're working backwards from whatever breadcrumbs are on the network of the victim to figure out on our end who did it. That the intelligence community may know well from other sources who was responsible. But when I think about bringing an indictment, I'm sourcing that from unclassified information, and so I'm often starting with victim information and moving from there.
Going back to the concept of deterrence, what the U.S. does to deter attacks that are happening now in cyberspace, I'd like to sort of open that up to all of you as well. I asked Tom initially, but it just seems that our adversaries keep coming and coming and coming, and we're holding back the waters of the dam to keep them from overwhelming the United States. Is that a fair assessment, or do you think there's been enough that's been achieved? Are the waters just coming and coming?
I would, just to start off from the DoD perspective, in 2015, we were starting to set up cybercoms capabilities, and we've been building those capabilities. But only since 2018, with the new DoD cyber strategy, have we taken a stance that is much more forward, the defending forward strategic posture. So we're really at just the front end, from our perspective, of doing the kinds of things that allow us to find things early and deal with them where they are from, which the place from which they originate. So we are just at the beginning part of that. So there'll probably be a clearer view of how well or poorly that's working as we move forward. And in addition to that, there's always room for improvement. Despite our great interagency relationships here, it's not just for the stage, we really do get along, but working with each other, because we each bring a different tool to the problem. And to the extent we can sit down and look at the same problem at the same time, that's going to give us a better batting average also. One last thing I'll say about that is, before I had the job up there on the marquee, I was a law professor. And as when you look at international law, there are two things that really deter countries from hurting you. One is denial of benefit. That is, your defenses are so good that even if they do this bad thing, they won't get what they want. Or it will cost them more, take more time, be more embarrassing. So we need to work harder on that domestically, and that is a team sport. And the other half of that is imposing costs. Some of that can be done domestically, but most of that is in the DoD's wheelhouse, and we are building the capabilities each year to be able to do that part of the job, our part of the job, better.
Do you think all of you have been in this space for a while, do you think there are opportunities in the past that were missed? I mean, for example, back in 2008, there was the Comprehensive National Cybersecurity Initiative that was sort of a plan to make United States critical infrastructure more secure, more resilient, harden it. And we lost time. It wasn't because of transition in governments or administrations, I should say. It just sort of, nothing was done on it. Do you think we really did miss an opportunity with regards to where we could be now?
Well, I think you learn from hindsight. And part of what I think we've learned, I'll just speak for myself, is, you know, when you choose not to disrupt an activity, when you choose not to respond, that is also a signal. And so there are definitely, with the benefit of hindsight, instances where I can look back and think, I don't know that this would have dramatically altered the calculus of the actors, but we could have more proactively disrupted what they were doing. And they obviously would have retooled, and they obviously would have come back at us if they really wanted to. And it might have escalated, but it also might have caused them to take a step back and pause. And so I think we're seeing, you know, I began by saying something to the effect of punks don't deter or something like that. What I meant by that is we should make a distinction between disruption, right? Knocking someone offline, knocking them off their game, making it harder to engage in that particular activity, and the deterrence of a higher level decision maker. Those are two different things, right? Bricking someone's computer is going to make it harder for them to launch an attack against you that day, but they'll get another computer, right? So you're not gonna necessarily, in the long term, change what they're doing, but there's a benefit to that disruption too. And so on the law enforcement side, I see the benefit to getting orders and taking down infrastructure and making it, you know, adding more sand in the gears and making it harder for them to do their job, but I distinguish that from deterrence, where you need to change the calculus of the leader of a nation or the senior military and foreign policy decision makers.
Okay, Steve.
To contribute to that thought, it seems like in terms of all of the ground that's been covered since the Comprehensive National Cybersecurity Initiative forward, it's been kind of a maturity model approach where it's hard to say at a point in time that we hadn't done enough or we missed an opportunity. We've been maturing all the way through. I think where we are today is an interesting place where all the levers of national power are now engaged, and you see very routinely that we will charge an actor, a state actor, with a criminal indictment. Treasury will issue sanctions. There may be some sort of a trade action. There may be a diplomatic push. State Department is doing a wonderful job in rallying the like-minded nations and being able to sequence other actions by other governments. And to Liesyl's original point, anything the U.S. can do will only individually have so much of an effect. But if we can have 20 and 30 countries coming out with us to join us in a statement of condemnation or to themselves bring consequences, pariah states will start to become more and more isolated. Whether we've actually changed their calculus yet right now, I don't know. But the activities that we're doing, I think if we keep on this path, will have an effect. And an interesting point that we've thought about at the FBI is, as we charge individual actors in Iran, and North Korea and China and Russia, state actors who have done these things. We kind of wonder, and I suspect that we may be changing the thought calculus of even the workforce. Where do I want to work? Do I want to work for an organization and I'll get caught and named, and next thing you know, I can't travel to Europe on vacation because I might get arrested? I wonder whether this is a new space where everyone in the ecosystem is making decisions about how they want to participate in it, and maybe they don't want to be working for an organization that's going to be causing them personal reputational harm and the ability to travel or study in the West. Just interesting food for thought.
I would just sort of add on, I like maturity. What I was going to say is evolutionary. The process of, you know, we've learned at each step of the way, what elements we need to bring to bear. And so every time there's been a new strategic approach, whether it was CNCI or whether it was the International Cyberspace Strategy or whether it was now the National Cyber Strategy, we've learned along the way and hardened our efforts collectively across the interagency to bring all these tools to bear. It didn't used to be that way with regard to cyber. So I would say, you know, we could look at it a little bit more glass half full, not my norm, but to look at a glass half full and say, you know, we have improved every step along the way. We have better mechanisms for coordination now and not across the interagency than we did. And so I would say that we've seized the opportunity in many cases.
So I think the most important thing is we are no longer the only nation routinely calling out by name activity by our adversaries that is disruptive to the entire world. Right. And that's not enough, right? Name calling is not gonna get the job done, but it is much easier to think of what the next step looks like now when you've got a group of nations no longer afraid to say, Russia did this, or China did this, or this is not what we should do.
And one big principle of sort of our deterrence strategy is transparency. So if you do call out a country for, then you've set the foundation for what the next activities are. That's definitely part of the process as well.
Right. And I would say just very briefly that, and that's where international law comes from. When we want to change customary international law, it comes from us saying, we believe these actions in cyberspace violate international law, but it also requires state practice. You need to come out and say, and therefore we are shutting down this group. Therefore we are not permitting that kind of intrusion. And when enough countries do that, then the great big ocean liner of international law moves in the right direction, and we start building a relevant international law for this century.
So we're about to open the floor up to questions. So anybody who wants to come to the mics, please feel free. But one of my last questions, and that is, when you think about one vital piece of critical infrastructure, that would be the upcoming elections, right? That has now been deemed critical infrastructure. We know what is happening. We have seen what is going on. The playbook is out there for everybody to read, even in the 37-page indictment that came out from the Justice Department Special Counsel. So what is being done to deter, in a way, the most fundamental attack where we know what the blueprint is likely to be, and they're getting more sophisticated in trying to defend and hide and shield what they're doing?
I'll start off very briefly on that, and that is when you're looking at election security, or from DOD's perspective, election defense, the main dichotomy is election interference, and Homeland Security has the lead on that. That's the mechanical part of the voting process. An adversary messing with the voting machines or vote tabulating computers or getting into the media or getting into a campaign's servers. So we are supporting players, DOD, to provide insights and then gathering information from what is being done, tracing those back to the originator, the malefactors, and then having a chat with them. Then the other part is influence, and that is the substantive part, adding a voice. And DOD has a role in preventing covert influence. We support FBI and their leadership of the U.S. Task Force on that. We are supporting player domestically, but internationally, we generate insights that our domestic partners can use, and then we trace that thread back internationally to the originator, and we deal with that there in an appropriate, lawful way.
Okay. You were first to the mic, so if you would tell me your name and maybe just a general description of what you do. You don't have to completely identify yourself, but let us know a little bit about yourself.
Charles Cresson Wood, I'm an attorney, and I specialize in information security and privacy. I'd like to back up a little bit and suggest that prevention and avoidance is preferable to deterrence. And everybody in this room, to some extent, is here because of a failure of the high-tech industry to build products which were adequately secure and private, for that matter. So my question to the panel is, and this is picking up on Stephen's point about attribution being key, If we can build more breadcrumbs, if we can build more forensics into the trails which are laid down by these foreign actors, and for that matter, domestic actors, we'll be in a position to use detection prevention systems and, intrusion detection systems and intrusion prevention systems. So you won't have to prosecute, you won't have to engage in diplomatic negotiations because there was no loss.
So is your question about whether forensics should be built in just to have a
My question is the federal government engaged with the high-tech industry in such a way that they could design new forensics to have real prevention and real avoidance rather than deterrence?
Okay. Thank you, Charles. Anyone?
I guess I'll lead that to stipulate this panel, as you can see, does not have Department of Homeland Security on it because we're focused more on the consequence imposition side of it. So stipulating that deterrence by denial is a key piece, and CISA at DHS and other agencies that have a role in working with the private sector and critical infrastructure owners and operators to build better defenses and harden things. Now, that is an essential piece. I personally can't speak to where that stands exactly and whether we're ever going to achieve that, but that's a great point that the better defended we are, the harder it is for the adversary to achieve their aims, and also it builds a better paper trail that we can use to advance our investigations.
Okay, Steve, thank you. Good question, Charles. You were next to the mic, so let me take you. Go ahead. Your name and just a brief title.
Yeah, thank you. Good morning. My name is Martha Vandrell. I am from Merck Pharmaceuticals. I'm the Director for IT Risk Management Policy. I'm not sure if you heard that before. So before I came to Merck, I actually worked in the U.S. Department of Defense. So the question I had is that regarding establishing international norms and countries agreeing not to attack each other's critical infrastructure. There are 16 critical infrastructure sectors. I'm wondering if that agreement or those agreements specifically call out something like hospitals and healthcare, because in the law of armed conflict, there are specifically provisions for not attacking each other's hospitals and medical things and so forth. And that's important now, especially if you look at coronavirus. You know, no country stands to benefit when you attack each other's critical infrastructure when it comes to healthcare. So I'm wondering if that is something that might be under discussion.
Great question.
So what we haven't done in the international discussions and frameworks is to have a universal definition of what is critical infrastructure.
Say it again, I'm sorry.
We haven't defined for the world what every nation's critical infrastructure would be. But that means that expressing, and each country should express what it is, so this is part of the confidence building measure, to know what countries think is their critical infrastructure. But one thing that is important to know is we did identify things that provide services to the public. So that could be hospitals, or that could be people dealing with pandemics.
One other note is that healthcare is out of the 16 critical infrastructure sectors. We are the second most hacked. Either number one or number two over the past 5 years.
Okay, thank you. Next question, name and description.
Yeah, Deb Shu, I'm with the MITRE Corporation. I work in cybersecurity strategy. And my question is probably a little uncomfortable. So nuclear deterrence worked because it was mutual assured destruction, and it was pretty clear that one company had, or one country over another had certain capabilities that could, in a sense, annihilate the other. In deterrence in cyberspace, which is a very different landscape and not visible, what is, how does deterrence work when, A, we don't really have a definition of an act of war? And for instance, to the lady's previous question, what constitutes actions that escalate and require a higher level of response? And then how is that response, I'm sorry, this is a complicated question. How do we, as the US, project power in that response? Because power in cyber means we have capability that we are willing to use when it's an act of war. And we have to develop that capability, and that may take us out of the accepted norms.
No, that's a great question, and we don't have an entire semester to deal with it, and I wish we did. Your question deserves that. Very briefly, there are tactical approaches where you work at the tactical level to deny the benefit of doing what they're doing and to impose costs. We can do the same thing with campaigns operationally. But at the end of the day, deterrence, whether it's capital D or lowercase d, is meant to work in one place, and that is inside the human element, inside the brain of the adversary decision maker. And that could be threatening the destruction of an entire country, or just their military forces, or just the leadership group of the country, or just denying that one leader, whoever she is, that she can't be the crazed dictator who gets what she wants. And if we can use cyber to be more precise than nuclear weapons, and we can aim at just that decision maker, and I think that would make Carl von Clausewitz really happy, and I think we would be able to be, it'd be a better defense paradigm for the century.
Do we have a sort of a formal continuum of responses, for example, that's laid out, you do this, we'll do this, you do that, we'll do that, and just, or has that been created?
And across all sectors.
Yeah, exactly. Anybody? Do we have that sort of? I'm going to throw it to Adam.
So I definitely think we have a sense of what a more what are more escalatory actions or what are more significant consequences versus others. I would caution against the comfort of rigidity. In other words, I do not think you want to plan and commit yourself in advance to a rote response, because every adversary is different, the consequences are different, and so that doesn't make sense. But yes, we've thought about. What for every major incident that we investigate, there's often some thought to, okay, what are our range of responses and what's the right way to calibrate this? To the last question, I think it's really important. The way to, as I understand the question, nuclear deterrence was symmetric in the sense that you deterred a nuclear attack with the threat of a nuclear attack. It is, I think, leaving a lot on the table if you say, well, the way to deter a cyber attack is with a cyber attack. That's not right at all. The way you deter anything is by a range of consequences. So at the Justice Department, we're pretty well called symmetric, right? I can only charge and indict and imprison the person who's guilty, who's responsible for the offense. Other nations, much more flexibility to put in jail someone because it creates leverage on another country. And we've actually seen other nations do that. So when you think about deterring cyber attack, let's remember, what you're trying to do is figure out what that nation's leader or decision makers fear and hope for and so forth. And that may not well be a cyber attack. Cyber is just a means of exercising state power, like sanctions, like prosecutions, like anything else. And so please, let's not get trapped in, to effectively defer cyber, you must have cyber operations.
So not tit for tat. Okay, wonderful. You are next to the mic, and then I'm going to go to you. So name and just description. And we'll try to go quickly because there's so many people. So go ahead.
Maureen Baksh, I'm a journalist, and I think it's important to note that the details in the indictments are allegations.
Correct.
My question is, can you say whether there was an effort to make a joint attribution around Equifax, and why not, and in general, what the process for pursuing joint attribution is, both within the US, so like, you know, you're discussing a possible indictment, whether you then say, okay, well, should we try to seek other countries to be in with this, with us on it, and then once you make that decision, what the process is like within the UN, perhaps?
I can answer it within my lane. So we're the Department of Justice, not the Department of Attribution. And I, when people use the word attribution on panels like this, I think a little bit more about a policymaker's decision to say publicly that country was responsible for that. That's a bit what we do in ring charges, but I'm not thinking about it in that same policy frame. I'm thinking I have evidence or not of what a particular person did, and I'm going to bring a case when the principles of federal prosecution, which sort of outline when you bring criminal federal cases, say I should. And that's really more of the Department of Justice's lane than it is an interagency discussion. There are plenty of instances where we bring cases in coordination with other nations. So in a sweeping, WADA is a good example of this, right? The GRU's targeting of Olympic medical records worldwide, the leaking of them, and the link between those actors and targeting of the OPCW and the Organization for the Prevention of
Prohibition of Chemical Weapons.
Thank you. So there was what I'll call joint attribution in the sense that we were working to investigate that case with authorities worldwide, and so we lined up when we would announce our charges with other nations because we had joint investigations. But it's not quite the same thing as the UN takes a vote and we're all going to announce something on the same day. I don't know if I've answered your question, you stepped away from the mic, but I just want to be very clear about the difference between policy attribution and charging a criminal case, because if that gets blurred, I think we lose a little bit from my department's perspective.
I'm going to go to the next question. Go ahead. Name and description.
Jordan D'Amato. I'm at CrowdStrike. Just quickly, we talked a bit about a cost imposition. Is it a critical part of deterrence? And I know that there are some, you know, as you've mentioned, concerns about what you can release publicly, both in terms of ongoing operations and kind of looking forward and what you can not. But I'd be curious to hear from any and all of you about the types of sort of public or strategic communications that go along with any of the operational cost imposition that happens. Because I think as a citizen, I'm sometimes left wondering, you know, Russia is doing X, China is doing Y, what are we doing in response? And I know that, you know, there are sensitivities around that, but I'd be curious to hear if you guys think.
Messaging. Steve.
I guess I'll lead off, and at least we probably have something to say about this. Oftentimes the consequences being imposed, the mode we're going to use, will drive kind of the method for how that messaging is put out. So if the Treasury Department is going to be unveiling some sanctions, then you'll see that statement come from Secretary Mnuchin, and there'll be a certain amount of details backing that up. If it's a Justice Department indictment that's being unsealed, then it's going to be extraordinarily detailed. If it's statements, for instance, that Secretary Pompeo makes, along with international partners, more of a diplomatic statement, maybe that's going to be shorter. So it kind of varies depending upon who's the mouthpiece. There's been a lot of discussion within the interagency about what's the right mode and method and mouthpiece for a particular public statement of that sort. There's not fully a paint by the numbers guide on that yet.
I think we have time for maybe one, maybe two more questions. Go ahead. Name, description.
Hi there. I'm Rafael Satter with Reuters. There's been a lot of talk about deterring adversaries in cyberspace. I was wondering if you guys could talk a little bit about deterring allies in cyberspace.
Absolutely.
And how that's different, if it's different.
Great question.
Of course. Very brief answer to a really good question is one of our asymmetrical advantages as a country is that we have friends, we have allies, not just countries that are scared of us or want to get out of our way. Some of them really like us and want to work with us. And there's some degree of cyber cooperation possible with almost all of the countries in the world. So we're working hard with our interagency partners and international partners, but there is a huge amount of room for improvement in the depth and complexity of cooperation with international partners, at the very least so that smaller, less capable partners are not just used as a black hole by adversaries to launch what they want to launch. But you're absolutely right, and there's a long list of countries we can do many, many things with cooperatively, and we need to be getting after that.
Okay. Go ahead.
Hello. My name is Dipankar Dasgupta. I'm a professor at the university. I have some fundamental questions. Cyber infrastructure was never built to support businesses, governments from its scratch. Now, what is happening that the cyberspace becoming, you know, while it has a tremendous benefit, has a gossip place for users, and then the hackers' playground, criminals' marketplace, and now nation states' battleground. So what will happen as the trust is, what will be the consequence of diminishing trust in cyberspace?
Okay, thank you. Liesyl, you want to take that?
Well, I think you raise a sort of a point we've not really discussed, which is that unlike nuclear weapons, shall we say, cyberspace is for everyone to use, to innovate, to communicate, to do commerce, you know, across the globe. And so it has a tremendous amount of opportunity for economic growth, economic development, so we can't lose sight of that. but an important element of that is sort of end users' trust. And that is something that we work a lot in, from the State Department's perspective, work a lot in international bodies or with our partners in regional organizations or bilaterally to keep the message that's an important factor, and that we you know, it may not have been created to with the security in mind at the very beginning in the garage back in the day, but it is something that has to be infused into the dialogue, into the work that everybody that's here at the conference is doing. Will there ever be absolute trust? That's a good question. But it is something we all want to strive for and keep the promise as part of the conversation.
Okay. Unfortunately, we are out of time, but we will take your questions perhaps on the side. Steve Kelly, Adam Hickey, Liesyl Franz, and Tom Wingfield, thank you very, very much. And we thank you all for coming and for your engagement. Thank you.